HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Jameela Green Ruins Everything by Zarqa Nawaz, performed by Aizzah Fatima. To my children, Mesa, Inaya, Rashad, and Zane, who needed proof that I wasn't online shopping for 8 years. Okay, maybe I was, but I still finished the book. Lily, Fajr Prayer, 6:07 a.m., October 6th. Dear Allah, Mom's disappeared. The CIA says she's killed people and that she's a terrorist. She is, but the kind who will fight you at a Kate Spade flash sale. Religion's never been her thing. I know she's been acting weird lately, but people don't get radicalized and run off to the Middle East to fight in a holy war that quickly. Unless terrorists sit around watching comedy specials on Netflix while online shopping, their lifestyle wouldn't appeal to her. I'm really scared. She could be a better person and mom, but I love her. Dad says her life has been complicated, and the complications have caught up to her. I'm doing what the imam at the mosque, Brother Ibrahim, taught me. Be patient and ask you for help. So please help. But Brother Ibrahim is missing too. Something is very, very wrong. 9 days earlier. 1. Maybe the prayers had finally worked. Jameela scanned the growing crowd in the New York Public Library's 6th floor. She was impressed. Her publicist, Arlene Baker, waved. She had on her uniform, a powder blue pantsuit last seen on Hillary Clinton or Chairman Mao. Jameela waved back.
Great crowd!
Gushed Arlene as she tottered up to Jameela in matching heels, windmilling her arms to maintain her balance. She air-kissed Jameela with her perfect raspberry pout. Jameela wondered how her lipstick never came off. Maybe it was tattooed on.
I haven't seen a book launch this big in a while, Arlene said. And I've been to 2 others already this week.
I know why they're here, said Jameela. I've been trying something new.
What?
Praying. Jameela hadn't prayed since Jamal, but now there was something she needed badly. After decades of work, Jameela had finished her memoir. She looked up, trying to find God in the tin-stamped ceiling. Remember what we talked about, she thought. You will make my book go right to the top of the New York Times bestseller list, like you do for all the white people you love so much. J.K. Rowling, Margaret Atwood, or even better, Malcolm Gladwell. That guy doesn't need any more number one books. And he has enough hair on his head to stuff a whole pillow. Do any of those people even believe in you? Probably not. In the Quran, Prophet Solomon asked for a kingdom greater than anyone's before or after, plus to talk to animals, and you gave it to him. So now it's my turn. I want a literary career greater than anyone else's. I don't want to talk to ants or anything, unless they know how to order a book from Amazon. So that's it. Immortal literary success. If you need to send me a sign, use a grilled cheese sandwich. That's what you do for Christians, right? Arlene touched Jameela's arm and brought her back to earth.
That's so funny, sweetie. I thought you said praying. So much press here. So fantastic. And your mom and her friends came too. How sweet.
Jameela turned to see her mother, Nusrat, arriving with 5 of her Pakistani friends, all wearing bright jewel-toned shalwar kameezes. She acknowledged them with a curt nod, her right hand in her jacket pocket, rubbing the blue marble prayer beads her brother, Jamal, had given her as a child. People streamed in by the dozens. She should have tried praying long ago. Who knew God could be so responsive? But then, Courtney Leland entered. Jameela froze. The familiar chill of dread ran up her spine, even after all these years. Why was that woman here? Oh no. Suddenly, it made sense why people were rushing to get front row seats. Jameela clutched her prayer beads so tightly her fingers hurt. Fear and anxiety sparked through her body. she was instantly transported back to high school, a time when she and her mother had constantly fought over her clothing choices. She was forced to wear pants under her dresses, and any hairstyle besides pigtails was deemed too alluring. If Anne of Green Gables had been brown with a unibrow and a mustache, Jameela would have been her doppelganger. During that tumultuous period, her brother had convinced her to join the yearbook staff to gain experience as a writer and develop confidence. By her senior year, she had become editor of the school yearbook and eked out a niche for herself. Until Courtney joined the team and, like a black hole, absorbed all whose eyes gazed upon her. In that year's yearbook, their group photograph featured a smiling Courtney standing in the front of everyone, hands on hips, partly blocking Jameela's face. The caption, "editor," was typed under her photo. She looked exactly the same now as she had back then, maybe a bit thinner and blonder. Her clothing choices perhaps had become more cutting edge. She wore knee-high black suede boots with stiletto heels over black leggings, a mini skirt, and an orange jacket with metal zippers everywhere. It looked like she'd just thrown the outfit together, but Jameela could tell that it was all high-end designer. "I'm not in high school anymore. I'm an accomplished woman. Please, everyone, look at me," she thought. The camera swung toward Courtney. Arlene came and sat beside a devastated Jameela. "How did she know about this event?" Jameela whispered through clenched teeth. Reporters mobbed Courtney, who was turning her head at an angle perfected by 1,000 Instagram photos. Her lips were parted just so, and her eyes looked off into an unknown distance. She even took out a pair of tortoiseshell glasses and posed with one of the ends lightly touching her lip. Was that even sanitary? Courtney put them on while tossing her hair, which also seemed to know exactly where to land. She screamed, "Sexy librarian," while Jameela suddenly felt matronly in her sensible brown walking shoes. Arlene picked a piece of fluff off her lapel. The truth finally hit Jameela. "You didn't."
"Jameela, listen to me. You're a first-time author of a good book, yes, but you don't have name recognition yet. We have a hard time getting people to Margaret Atwood anymore. It was the only way."
"What do you mean, the only way? It's my book launch. Why does she get top billing?"
"I may have suggested to her that it was going to be an interview-style launch with..."
"Courtney's going to interview me?"
"You were best friends in high school, so it makes perfect sense."
"We were not best." Arlene stepped on Jameela's toe as Courtney approached the women. A cloud of perfume following her like low-lying cumulus clouds.
"Arlene, thanks for asking me to be part of your event. It was so kind of you."
"Thanks for fitting us in,"
replied Arlene. Jameela could sense Arlene was trying hard not to gush. If they hadn't been surrounded by people, Jameela would have throttled Arlene for picking the one person on earth who had betrayed her during her most vulnerable time. She had to appear gracious, or people would suspect the truth. She was jealous of Courtney's career success.
"Yeah, thanks," she added.
"Oh, you're so welcome," said Courtney, turning her attention to Jameela. "We were besties in high school," she told Arlene. "Jameela let me take over the yearbook so I could use it on my resume. And it worked. I became the editor-in-chief of Dazzle, launched my literary career. Under my leadership, we now have more subscribers than Cosmo."
"That's so kind of Jameela," exclaimed Arlene. "Always thinking of others before herself."
"Yes. So, how could I keep away when I heard about Jameela's book? I wanted to be part of the excitement."
Jameela's fingers dug deeply into Arlene's arm.
"Ouch!"
she yelped, pulling her arm away. "Thank God guns aren't allowed in public libraries."
"You shouldn't have, really. You must be so busy with your own book promotion."
Jameela tried to slow down her breathing.
"Think nothing of it. My own parties are getting exhausting. But enough about me. Nothing like the first book. Almost like having a baby, isn't it? Except that it doesn't ruin your body. Oh, but you look great, considering.
Did you only have one?
Courtney looked critically at Jameela's stomach. Thanks, said Jameela, pulling her cardigan protectively around her. Is that gray hair?
Arlene yanked Jameela toward her and whispered fiercely.
Behave! She brings more publicity to your event. Look, she's already on stage. Follow her.
Arlene went up to the mic and took some papers out of her powder blue purse. Jameela wondered if she'd had each piece of her outfit dyed together in the same vat.
I'd like to welcome everyone to the official launch of Jameela Green's Mainly Muslim, a tour de force memoir about a woman born in suburbia to conservative Pakistani parents. To help us celebrate, we have a special guest, Courtney Leland, the author of Will Anyone Save Me? A book about her harrowing year in captivity in Iraq before her dramatic rescue by Navy SEALs. It's been on the New York Times bestseller list for more than 30 weeks with no sign of slowing down.
Courtney sat in a plush burgundy velvet chair opposite Jameela, who saw her short skirt get shorter. She reeked of sophistication and glamour, while Jameela felt like a frumpy middle-aged mother. After the applause died down, Courtney took off her orange jacket to reveal a transparent black blouse with a racy red bra underneath. Every eye turned to her. Even Jameela had a hard time looking away. Courtney took the mic, which was sitting on a small table between them.
So, Jameela, I've read your book. It was very funny.
Thank you. I thought I could read from the first chapter. Courtney looked like she just realized the event was about Jameela and not her.
Is it a short chapter?
Jameela ignored her and opened her book to the section she'd marked and began reading. I picked up a bottle of soda from the grocery shelf, but my mother snatched it and eyed the label suspiciously. It says root beer. She put it back. But, Ummi, it's not real alcohol. It's just a name and it tastes good, I whined. My mother stared at me. Where did you drink it? It was a rare fatal error. My friend Emily shared her can with me at school. My mother was furious. What kind of principal runs your high school? They ban peanuts but allow pretend alcohol? No wonder this society is so dangerous, full of alcoholics and drug users. I'll be speaking to him about indoctrination on Monday. I silently returned the root beer to the soft drink.
Was your mother always so strict? Interrupted Courtney.
Not always, thought Jameela. She remembered trips to the West Coast when she and Jamal were young. Those were the days when her mother didn't care about the scantily clad men and women lying on the beach or what anyone was drinking. She was another person. Jameela had been 14 and had just started high school, where Jamal was a senior. He died a week before his graduation.
She became strict when I started high school. Speaking of high school, didn't your mother have an issue with the shorts that were mandatory in gym class? You rebelled by wearing them at school behind her back, even though you didn't know how to shave your legs. You describe yourself as looking like a hairy tarantula in boxers, but I thought you looked adorable.
Jameela bristled at Courtney for trivializing her personal stories of assimilation.
My mother wasn't exposed to hair removal. Boys and girls both wore cotton shalwar kameezes at school. That's a long shirt with baggy trousers, so their legs were always covered and not judged the way they are here. Jamal had been the one to tell her to be patient with their parents. Shorts and gym class were foreign to her mother, who had grown up in Pakistan and needed time to adjust. He came up with the idea of Jameela wearing track pants, and even went to talk to the principal about changing the dress code, which allowed Jameela to participate in sports at her mother's comfort level. But after Jamal died, there was no one to mediate, and a wall went up between Jameela and her parents. They wanted her to become a doctor, but she wanted to study creative writing and become a writer. She might as well have told them she wanted to become a ferret. If Jamal had lived, she would have had an ally. But after he died, she had no one until she met Murray in college, where Jameela secretly took writing classes and started chronicling her experiences growing up in an eccentric American Muslim Pakistani household. It had taken her a decade and a half to finish her memoir and find a publisher, but here she was. Courtney turned to Jameela. But the cultural differences are deeper than clothes. Some Muslims don't date in high school. Why is that? Jameela was glad that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.